today is we're going to do a PCR reaction. And the goal of the reaction is to amplify or recover the 16S rRNA DNA gene sequence, which I realize is a bit of a mouthful. So let's just back up and remember what ribosomes are, and then that will help put the lab in context. So when you're learning about gene expression, you learn about how DNA encodes a protein, or a peptide more accurately. So that DNA gene gets converted to messenger RNA through a process called transcription, and then that gets converted to peptides, right, a string of amino acids through the act of translation. And we were learning about that recently in class. So the thing that does translation are these small structures in the cell called ribosomes. And they kind of look like hamburgers. So I drew a green ribosome here. There's a large subunit, which is the top bun, and then there's a small subunit, which is the bottom bun. So large subunit, small subunit. And then this ribosome, my drawing is supposed to show that it is on a piece of messenger RNA, so it's doing translation. And I didn't draw the little peptide coming up, just to keep the drawing simpler, okay? That's a ribosome doing translation. Now I want to zoom in on the small subunit and remember, or state, that what makes up a ribosome are two things. They're built out of protein and ribosomal RNA. Shorthand for that is rRNA. So when you look at this picture, you're looking at messenger RNA that carries information, but you're also looking at rRNA mixed together with protein to make these structures. Ribosomes are found in all cellular life forms, and they're largely the same in all cellular life forms. So this person, these two scientists, Carl Woese and Jeffrey Fox, they figured out that you could look at the sequence of one of the pieces of ribosomal RNA and that it would act as essentially a fingerprint that lets us identify and classify the creature holding this ribosome. And that was actually a genius discovery. And in so doing, they discovered that there was a third domain of life, which is called the archaea. More on that at another time. Our point here today is, if you're asking the question, what's this bacteria? Want to identify it and maybe classify its evolutionary relationships? If you know the sequence of that little bit of rRNA, and that specific type is called the 16S rRNA, at least in bacteria. In eukaryotes, it's called the 18S, but we're focusing on bacteria today. You can determine that sequence by doing DNA sequencing. But in order to do DNA sequencing, you have to first recover the gene that encodes that piece of rRNA. And so there's kind of a lot to this, and it really kind of strengthens your knowledge of gene expression and like RNA and DNA if you really drill in on this lab. So our goal is to look at the sequence. So here's this mystery bacteria. See, we don't know what it is, right? And it's gonna have a chromosome, one circular chromosome inside it. And it's gonna have little ribosomes in it, and they contain the 16S rRNA gene. But it's kind of tricky to sequence RNA. It's easier to sequence DNA. So our goal is to recover the specific region on the chromosome that encodes the 16S rRNA. And in order to recover it, we want to get a lot of it so that we can work with it easily. Because it's easier to work with something if you have a lot of it than if you have a little bit of it. So what you would do in the total experiment is you have your bacteria, you'd extract DNA, and we'll learn how to do that in another lab. And then you take that DNA and you would kind of think of it as photocopying it, make lots and lots of copies of it. And that copying process is what we call PCR. And PCR is short for polymerase chain reaction. That's what we're gonna do today, okay? So, on to the PCR part. So when we're doing PCR, there will be a target gene, we call it. It's the language that we use like shooting practice, like a target, right? Which is kind of a nice analogy, but whatever. So here's our target. It's this little bit here that we're trying to recover. You have to know quite a bit about the target to make this experiment work. So it's the kind of thing that you have to have advanced knowledge from. And you can get that in a number of ways, like studying similar organisms, seeing what their sequences look like. Once you have that knowledge, you look at the target sequence, and these blue lines are supposed to be that. And if you guys remember that DNA has ends, has a 3' end and a 5' end, and that the complementary strand will be oriented in the anti-parallel configuration, where it's 3 on one side, it's 5 on next. Where there's an A here, there would be a T here. Okay? I haven't drawn all that just to keep the figure simpler. So we're going to take advantage of that knowledge. Part of being able to do PCR is to be able to design primers. And this is where base pairing is important. So if you know what you're trying to amplify or grow through PCR, then you go in and you find the ends of it, and you look at the sequence right there, right there. So if the sequence in the gene here is TAG, you want to design a primer, and the word primer means short piece of nucleotides. Here it's DNA. You would design this primer so that where there was a G here, there'd be a C. Where there's an A there, there'd be a T. Where there's a T, there'd be an A, and so on. And you would design the primer so that it would base pair, which means if the G is on the 3' end, the C's got to be on the 5' end. So you're really specific about the identity and the orientation of the primer so that it will stick there. You do the same thing for the opposite side, because your primers have to flank the region you want to amplify. So if this was CGG, the primer would be CCG, but in the opposite orientation. This is the 3' end of the sequence we're trying to base pair to. We've got to put the complement on the 5' end of the primer shown in green. This end will be the 3' for that little primer. This would be 5, and this would be 3. Makes sense? And maybe I want to amplify all of this, or maybe I want a shorter chunk, and I just want to amplify this. Then I could use this primer, but I could build myself or design myself another one to stick to whatever the sequence is up here. So I've got lots of options. In today's lab, we're going to amplify the gene that encodes the 16S rRNA. It's about 1,500 base pairs or nucleotides long, reasonably big, but not, humongous. We're going to actually amplify it sort of twice in two separate reactions. In one, we're going to use a forward primer, which is this one, called the 27 forward. And it gets called that because it binds to position 27, nucleotide 27, in the gene. And then on the other side, this one is going to be a primer called the 1522 reverse. It starts binding at nucleotide 1522 over here. It gets like pretty much the whole gene. In the second test tube that you'll use the same forward primer, but you'll use a different reverse primer. So it will stick somewhere around here at position 907 and close by. Each of them is about, 20 or so nucleotides long. I drew 3, but they're really about 20 nucleotides long to get enough sticking. So that's what we'll do in lab today. So that means we'll set up two PCR reactions. Each tube is a reaction, and a reaction here means stuff that you mix together to get the PCR to work.
This is a list of the ingredients of the PCR.
So we, and this can vary from lab to lab, and you can shop and buy different kinds of ingredients, but they all boil down to the same thing. You have to have target or template DNA to amplify. You've got that out of your original sample. You have to have primers, plural, because it has to be a pair. And you have to have a source of the enzyme that synthesizes DNA. Because during PCR, this is going to extend, this is going to extend. That's DNA synthesis. The enzyme that does that in the cell is called DNA polymerase. And in PCR, we often use kind of special ones that come from heat-loving microbes. We'll use one called TAQ, T-A-Q, short for a bacteria called Thermus aquaticus, which originally came from a hot spring in Yellowstone National Park, where it's super hot. So it's got these heat-stable enzymes. So this is DNA polymerase, fancy version, good at high temperature, right? We also need to have nucleotides. We need A's, C's, T's, and G's. Because if you're going to build DNA, then you need the building blocks. And those are nucleotides. And then we need buffer. Because we can't just do this in water or the enzyme won't work. So we use buffer that is set at a certain pH, certain saltiness, and it's got a key component. It's got magnesium chloride. Without the magnesium in there, the enzyme won't work. It needs that as a cofactor or a helper in order to do its job. In the reactions we'll do, we buy a very handy, what's called master mix, where all these things are mixed together, and they're mixed together at twice the concentration that they're needed in the final reaction, 2x concentration. So we'll put 25 microliters of this master mix in. We'll put 1 microliter of each primer in. There's a certain concentration that that gets them to be, because like all chemistry, this is concentration dependent. We won't get into that now. We'll use 1 microliter of DNA template, and we checked that we have a template that's concentrated enough that a microliter gets you enough template. And then we take all of that and we add 22 more microliters of water just to get the final volume to 50. Why 50? It's small enough that we don't use too much of these expensive reagents, but it's large enough that we can do things like DNA sequencing or gel electrophoresis or both afterwards and still have a little bit left over in case you want to keep studying this thing. So this is a volume that works well, like empirically or in our hands. We'll mix all this stuff together and then we'll take our 2 test tubes and we'll run the PCR, which means put them through something called a thermal or temperature gradient. So we have a nice machine for this. The machine used to be whoever ranks lowest in the lab, usually the undergraduate student, who would sort of stand there and move tubes from place to place through water baths. And that wasn't a lot of fun for an hour or two. So we put our tubes in a machine that does that work for us now, happily. We heat the mixture up to almost boiling, not quite, but almost, 95 degrees C. That takes the template DNA and melts it apart. Then we run the whole thing through these quick little cycles, in total 35 times, which works well for this experiment. It might be less, and it might be more for other PCR machine experiments. But this is sort of ballpark in the middle. 95 degrees melts the template apart. 55 degrees lets the primers stick, but not everything back together. It's kind of a sweet spot. 72 degrees, which is pretty warm, right? We're 37 and a half for reference, so it's pretty hot. But that's where the enzyme, the bacterium that gave up this enzyme, loves to live. So that enzyme's super happy at 72 degrees. That's the temperature at which extension happens. New DNA is made, copying the old DNA. Photocopier is working at that temperature. then we loop back around, do it again. Back around, do it again. The machine is doing this for us. We're having coffee or something at this time, right? So every time you go through one cycle, you should double the number of starter molecules or template molecules. If you started with one, within one cycle you get two, in the next cycle you get four, eight, 16, and so on. So you can go from a little bit exponentially to a lot in a very short amount of time, right? And you can end up with millions of molecules, and it's easier to work with a big haystack than a really, really tiny haystack. It's just easier to handle and to look at. At the very end, there's typically kind of a polishing step where you hold everything at that 72 degrees, and that like trims off the ends a little bit, stabilizes the mixture. And then you might not be around to take the tubes off the machine. You might have gone to a class, right? Or gone off and done some other work, or gone home for the evening. So the machine will hold the sample at 4 degrees C, which is the temperature of a typical refrigerator, until you go and, you know, get the sample and turn it off. So it's a cool cycle. And that's, at that stage, then you're ready to take your tube, and what you should have in there is a whole bunch of this original molecule. If you know what primers you used, you know what size those molecules should be. So if we used this primer pair, it should be about 1522 minus 27, right? A little bit less than 1,500 base pairs long. I should have a lot of a molecule, close to 1,500 base pairs. If I use this, I should have a lot of a molecule that's about, you know, just under 900 base pairs. On a gel, which we will do next, we load those two samples in a gel. This product should be bigger than this one. So it should run up here somewhere. This one should run down here somewhere. We should see that they're different sizes. And if we compare them with a known sample that contains a mixture of samples, you know, we should be able to ballpark that one's about 1,500. That one is about 900. Just with our eyes. We can also analyze it and be more precise, but we can ballpark it with our eyes. We could see that there's product. We could tell that it's about the right size, what we were expecting using the gel. And I won't get into that here. All right, let's get started, okay?